Good morning. Today we are starting with chapter 5, Morphology of Flowering Plants. There are wide range of plants that we always get fascinated to, and angiosperms, they show a large variety of external structure or morphology, which are characterized by the presence of roots, stems, leaves, flowers and fruits. So we need to know about the possible variations in different parts, adaptations of the plants to different environment, and adaptations to various habitats for protection, climbing, storage, etc. So in this chapter, we'll be taking up all these topics. There is a large diversity in the external structure or morphology of the plants. We'll be studying about the roots, different regions of the roots, modifications of the root. We'll be talking about stem, modifications of stem, the leaf, venation, the type of leaves, phyllotaxy and modifications of leaves. We'll also discuss about inflorescence, the flower, parts of a flower, fruit, seed and the semi-technical description of a typical flowering plants and description of some important families. So let's begin with the root. In majority of the dicotyledonous plants, the direct elongation of the radicle, you can see here the elongation of the radicle, that it results in the formation of a primary root which grows inside the soil, and it bears lateral roots. You can see here these are the lateral parts of the roots. These are of several orders and they are referred to as secondary, tertiary roots, etc. So the primary root and its branches, they constitute the taproot system. So this type of system is called as the taproot system. It is also seen in the mustard plant, and in monocotyledonous plants, the primary root is short-lived and is replaced by a large number of roots. You can see here the fibrous roots. And this type of roots originate from the base of the stem and they constitute the fibrous root system. So you can see the difference in the taproot system and the fibrous root system. In some plants like grasses, monstera and banyan tree, roots, they arise from the parts of the plants which are other than the radicle, and they are called as the adventitious roots. The main functions of the root system, we already know, they are, that is the absorption of water, minerals from the soil, provide proper anchorage to the plant parts, storing the reserve food material, and the synthesis of plant growth regulators. Regions of the root. The root is covered by an apex or a thimble-like structure, which is also called as the root cap. And it protects the very tender and soft apex of the root as it takes its way through the soil, and a few millimeters above the root cap is the region of meristematic activity. The cells of this region are very small, thin-walled, and they have a dense protoplasm. They divide repeatedly, and the cells which are of this region, they undergo rapid elongation, enlargement, and they are responsible for the growth of the root in the length. So this region is called as the region of elongation, and the cells of the elongation zone, they gradually differentiate and mature, and this zone, which is proximal to the region of the elongation, is called as the region of maturation. From this region, some of the epidermal cells form very fine, thin, delicate thread-like structures which are called as root hair. And the root hairs absorb water and minerals from the soil. Modifications of root. Roots in some plants, they change their shape and structure and become modified to perform functions which are other than absorption and conduction of water and minerals. They are modified for support. They are modified for support, storage of food, as well as respiration. The taproot of carrot, turnip, and sweet potato, and adventitious, these are the adventitious roots of the sweet potato. They get swollen and they store food. There are many other examples where you can find the storage of the food is there. Now these hanging structures which support a banyan tree, what they are, what they are called as. They are called as the prop roots and the stems of the maize and sugarcane. They also have supporting roots which are coming out of the lower nodes of the stem, and these are called as tilt roots. In some plants such as rhizophora, that which are growing in swamps, these are rhizophora which are growing in the swamps, and many roots, they come out of the ground and they grow vertically upwards, and such roots are called as pneumatophores, and they help to get oxygen for respiration also. Stem. What are the features that distinguish a stem from a root? The stem is the ascending part of the axis which is bearing branches and flowers, leaves, fruits also. It develops from the plumule of the embryo of a germinating seed, and the stem bears nodes and internodes. You can see here which are the nodes. These are the nodes, and in between them, these are the internodes. So the region of the stem where leaves are born, these are called as the nodes. And while internodes, these are the portions which are between the two nodes. Between the two nodes, the region is called as the internode. The stem bears buds which are terminal or axillary. You can see here, this is the axillary bud and this is the terminal bud. Terminal bud is at the apical position, and laterally when the bud arises, that is called as the axillary bud. Stem is generally green when young, and later it becomes woody and dark brown. The main function of the stem is spreading out branches, bearing leaves, flowers, fruits, etc. And it conducts water minerals for photosynthesis, and some stems perform the function of the storage of food also. Support, protection, and the vegetative propagation. Modifications of the stem. The stem may not always be typically like what they are expected to. They are modified to perform different functions. Underground stem of potato, you can see here the diagram, potato and ginger and turmeric, okay, in the turmeric, in jimikand, in colocasia, they are modified to store food in them. And they are also acts as the organs of perination to tide over the unfavorable conditions for growth. Stem tendrils. Okay, when we see the modifications of the stem, we can find stem tendrils. They are spirally coiled and they help plants to climb, such as in gourds, cucumber, pumpkin, watermelon, grapevines, etc. Axillary buds of the stem may also get modified to woody, straight and pointed thorns. And thorns, they are found in many plants such as citrus, bougainvillea, etc. They protect plants from animals, and some plants of the arid regions, they modify their stems into flattened opuntia or flesh cylindrical euphorbia like structures. And now they contain chlorophyll and they also carry out photosynthesis. Underground stems of some plants such as grasses and strawberry, they spread in new niches, and where the older parts they die and the new plants they are formed. In plants like mint and jasmine, here you can see mint and jasmine, is such type of plants, a slender lateral branch arises from the base of the main axis, and after growing aerially for some time downwards to touch the ground, a lateral branch with short internodes and each node bearing a rosette of leaves or a tuft of roots is found in aquatic plants like pistia or acornia. In banana, pineapple and chrysanthemum, the lateral branches, they originate from the basal underground portion of the main stem. And they grow horizontally and they bear soil, and then they come out obliquely upwards, giving rise to the tuft of leafy shoots. Leaf. The leaf is the lateral, generally flattened structure that is born on the stem, and it develops at the node. It develops at the node and it bears a bud in its axis. So the axillary bud. later develops into a branch. Leaves originate from the shoot apical meristem and they are arranged in an acropetal order. Acropetal order means the young ones towards the apex and the older ones towards the base. They are most important vegetative organs for photosynthesis. A typical leaf consists of three main parts: a leaf base, you can see here the leaf base, a petiole, and the lamina. So the leaf is attached to the stem by the leaf base and may bear two lateral small leaf like structures which are called as stipules. So here the stipules can also be present. And in monocotyledons, the leaf base expands into a sheath covering the stem, which is partially or wholly. In some leguminous plants, the leaf base may become swollen, which is also called as pulvinus. And the petiole, they help hold back to the light, and the long, thin, flexible petiole allow leaf blades to flutter in wind and cooling the leaf and bringing fresh air to the leaf surface. The lamina or the leaf blade or lamina, it is the green expanded part of the leaf with veins and veinlets, you can see here, and there is usually a middle prominent vein which is also known as the midrib. So the veins provide rigidity to the leaf blade and acts as a channel for the transport of water, minerals and food materials. And the shape, margin, apex, surface, extent of the incision of the lamina, it varies in different leaves. Venation. The arrangement of the veins and veinlets in the lamina of the leaf is known as venation. When the veinlets form a network, and then venation is known as reticulate. It is net-like. And when the veins run parallel to each other within a lamina, so the venation is termed as parallel. So the leaves of the dicot generally possess reticulate venation, and the parallel venation is the characteristic of monocotyledonous plants. Types of leaves. A leaf is said to be simple when its lamina is entire, or when in size the incisions do not touch the midrib. And when the incisions of the lamina reach up to the midrib, breaking it into a number of leaflets, and then it is called as a compound leaf. And a bud is present in the axil of the petiole in both simple and the compound leaves, but in the axil of the leaflets of the compound leaf, but it is not in the axil of the leaflets of the compound leaf. So the compound leaf may be of two types: a pinnate compound leaf, where a number of leaflets are present in a common axis; the rachis, which are present in the midrib of the leaf as in the neem; and in palmately compound leaves, the leaflets are attached to a common point, that is the tip of the petiole, that is as in silk cotton. Phyllotaxy. Phyllotaxy is the pattern of arrangement of leaves on the stem or the branch. This is usually of three types: alternate, opposite, and whorled. In alternate type of phyllotaxy, we can see the single leaf arises at the each node in an alternate manner, as in China rose, mustard, and sunflower plant. In the opposite type, we can see a pair of the leaves, they arise at each node and the opposite to each other, as in Calotropis and guava plant. And if more than two leaves arises at the node and forms a whorl, then it is called as the whorl leaf, as in Alstonia. Modifications of leaf. Leaves are often modified to perform functions other than photosynthesis. They are converted into tendrils for climbing, as in the peas, or as the spines for defense, etc. And the fleshy leaves of the onion or garlic, they store the food. And in some plants such as Australian acacia, the leaves are small and short-lived, and the petioles in these plants, they expand and become green, and they synthesize food. They also synthesize food. So leaves of certain insectivorous plants such as pitcher plant, Venus flytrap, they are also modified leaves.